That which damages him, that which brings death, he's going to take that from our lives and he's going to burn them. What a baptism of fire. Well, what is chaff anyway? Well, it is the casing that covers the grain. Okay? The casing that covers the grain. You know, come harvest time, the chaff needs to be separated from the grain. The chaff is already useless. It is unnecessary. It has to be removed. Similarly, chaff refers to the unnecessary in our lives. The clutter that prevents us from experiencing our full potential in life. The way God intended us to be. Well, what are these? What are the chaffs in your life? What are the chaffs in your life right now? Well, this may be different forms of sins, unhealthy attitudes, unhealthy behaviors, unhealthy habits, unhealthy relationships. You know what? What is God going to do with them? What is Christ going to do with them? Well, he will take all these things that hold us back, this chaff, and he will burn them with an unquenchable fire. Amen? He will burn them with an unquenchable fire! Friends, this is what we Methodists call sanctification. Can you all say sanctification? You know what? First, we are justified, but then we are also sanctified. Amen? Meaning, first, we are pardoned for our sins. That's justification. But then, it doesn't end there. We are also made holy. It's like this, you know, I want to show this to my students. And yesterday, I have had the opportunity to have this illustration for my students when I teach about justification. Basically, let's say for example we are this vessel, this cup, filled with, you know, with filth, symbolizing our sins. Okay? When we are justified, here's what happens. Basically, when we give our lives to Jesus, according to Romans 1:17, the just shall live by faith. In Romans 5, Paul also said, we are justified by faith. And so, when we profess faith in Jesus, we accept Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior. Well, what happens is that God imputes us with the righteousness of Jesus. The key word is imputes, or covers. Okay, we are covered by the righteousness of Jesus. And so when God looks at us, God no longer sees the sin that is in us. Amen? So that means we are justified. That means we are pardoned when we profess faith in Jesus. Are you justified? If you are justified, if you profess faith in Jesus, then you are justified. Well, let's give the Lord a big clap offering for that. We are made clean. Okay? God no longer sees us as sinners. But here's the thing. Here's the dilemma. Yes, we are justified. We are covered by the righteousness of Jesus. But when you go home, your neighbor sees you. Your neighbor will say to you, oh, I see that you are covered by the righteousness of Jesus. Is he going to say that? Probably he's going to say, where's my 20 bucks? Okay? You know, it's gonna see your old life. It's gonna see your failures that will come out from time to time. Okay? So this, because why? Because you're still living in your sinful nature. There's still that sinful nature that is in you. But you know what? It's a dilemma. And so God doesn't only cover us with the righteousness of Jesus. God also moves to impart us with the righteousness of Jesus. God addresses this problem of sin, of the sinful nature in our lives. So that process is called sanctification. Amen? So that's why, for example, sometimes we wonder, Pastor, I already accepted Jesus, I think I'm already born again. But then suddenly, why do I still sin from time to time? You know, probably I did not accept Him in the first place. Should I need to accept Him again? Should I need to be born again and born again and again and, you know, always come to the altar all the time? You know, it's like, I surrender some. I know. Okay? It's a never-ending cycle. And we think we're not really justified because we still see some signs of sins in our lives. But here's the thing. Here's the question I always ask of those people who ask me that question. Here's the question. Well, when you sin, what do you feel? Do you feel remorse? Yes. Do you feel sorry right away when you mess up? Yes. Well, then again, that means you're born again. Amen? Because why? Because sin is no longer the normal in your life. Hello? Sin is now the anomaly. Amen? That's why sin doesn't belong there. Yesterday, I told the people in the seminar yesterday, you know, it's like, you know, this one time I had a splinter, you know, a splinter. So the small wood got wedged in my thumb. And so deep I can't pull it out. And you know what? My wife has a background because she was a dentist in the Philippines. And she said, you know what? Just let it be. Let it stay there. It's going to go out eventually. Is that right? Yes, she was right. That's why husbands, listen to your wives, okay? So a few days later, the splinter went out. Why? Because it's not part of my body. It's not part of, you know, it's not the normal in my life. It's the abnormal. It's the same thing with us when we are justified, we are born again. But that doesn't mean that, you know, that we're not going to stop sinning, that we're going to stop sinning already. No. But here's the thing, when we sin, sin is no longer normal in our lives. Sin becomes an anomaly. Amen? Amen? So that's why, what? God is in the process of renewing us. He's going to address this problem of sin in our lives. So let me just show you what happens. Okay? Here's what, according to Paul in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, can we all read this? Can we say this together? 1, 2, 3. So see, there is what we would call entire sanctification. Yes, we are sanctified, but it's just the beginning. But God is in the process of sanctifying us entirely, completely, through and through. And who sanctifies us? Who does this work of sanctification? The Holy Spirit. Jesus, who baptizes us with the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire. So let me just show how this works. And so basically this is us. Can someone hold the movement?
So it's basically
this, okay? It's through the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. God helps us to deal with the remaining sin in our lives. He's gonna purify us. He's gonna sanctify us entirely. It's like this water, which is a symbol for the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So as we continue on in life, okay, sometimes we deal with sin, but you know, as we continue to ask God to sanctify us, to fill us with His Holy Spirit over and over again in our lives, what's going to happen? Entire sanctification. Amen?
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 And it can only happen with the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Amen? So let's give the Lord a big clap offering. That is what is known as entire sanctification. Okay? The Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, there will be a work of renovation. that will take place in our lives. Christ will turn our wildernesses around and they will become farmlands. Church, I believe we all have our own wildernesses or deserts in our lives. This may come in many shapes, in many sizes. But you know what? I remember as a teenager, one of my wildernesses was my insecurities. I had a very low self-esteem. I suffered what we would call an inferiority complex. I know I'm hardly sleeping in a shell and was scared to go beyond the place where I was already comfortable. Whenever I'm with other kids, you know, from well-off families or perhaps with nicer clothes, I'm reminded about, you know, how poor we were. But somehow, despite of my paranoia with other people, I ended up attending youth camp, and I attended CI, Christmas Institute, at the age of 14. And there I surrendered my life to Jesus. And when that happened, something happened after that. Somehow, knowing God, that God loves me and led me to accept who I was, Christ enabled me to shed those layers I built around myself. I found myself gaining more confidence in school. I found myself helping in the mission outreach of my church. And I began to take leadership roles. That wilderness of my life, Christ turned it into an abundant farmland. He turned it into a garden. But of course, that's just one wilderness in my life. There were others that I dealt with in the past. And I know you too are dealing with some kind of wilderness today. So today, let me be your prayer. I would like to challenge you to repent, to prepare the way for the Lord. Amen? So that Christ will come into the wilderness of your life, whatever that wilderness is, right now, and allow Him to change it into a garden, into an abandoned farmland. Allow Him to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. At this moment. May that be your desire. May that be your prayer today. Well, we'll continue on with the service. But later, when we sing 61st, I'm going to give an opportunity for us to experience Christ's baptism upon our lives. His sacrament baptism. Can we do that?
Yes?
Yes. Amen. Amen.